Welcome to Season 2 of Public Health On Call, a podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. I'm Joshua Sharfstein, Vice Dean for Public Health Practice and Community Engagement, and a former secretary of Maryland's Health Department. Our goal is to bring scientific evidence and experience to the public health news of the day through informative interviews with scientists, community leaders, policy experts, public health officials, clinicians, and more. If you have ideas or questions for us to cover, please email us at publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes. Today, Stephanie Desmond talks with Dr. Megan Latshaw of Johns Hopkins, co-author of an important new study about whether states are ready for the health effects of climate change. Let's listen.
Megan Latshaw, thanks so much for joining me.
Thank you. It's so nice to be here today, Stephanie.
So Megan, you're a co-author of a new report on climate change and health impacts. When you talk about these health impacts, what are you talking about?
Oh goodness, there's so many health impacts of climate change. So when you think about heat, for example, that's one of the most clear impacts of climate change. There are deaths, many deaths every year, just due to high temperatures. There have been increasing number of heat waves that have lasted longer and gotten hotter. And there have been more examples of deaths just from heat alone. And then if you start to talk about, you know, rising sea levels and flooding from increased and more severe storms, you know, the flooding can lead to health effects, whether it's related to mold that might grow after the floods go away and trigger asthma symptoms, or whether it's due to infectious diseases that might be transmitted due to wet conditions, which can create breeding grounds for mosquitoes. And increasing temperature also changes where mosquitoes are. And so we're seeing different diseases being carried by mosquitoes in different parts of the world that haven't seen those diseases before. Those are just some of the examples that come to mind.
So you're painting sort of an apocalyptic picture here. When you were creating this report, you're looking at how prepared states are to handle these effects of climate change. What did you learn?
So we learned that states need to do a lot more work to prepare for the health effects of climate change. You know, there were some states that have been working on this for a while, and they've done more than other states. You know, everything was relative. But what I think one of the most worrisome trends that we saw was that there are some of the most vulnerable states, vulnerable to climate change, are also some of the least prepared states to deal with the health impacts of climate change. And so that was something that we found that really concerned us.
And what states are you talking about there?
So they were mostly states in the South, Southeast. There were eight of them that we were particularly concerned about. Mississippi, Oklahoma, South Carolina, and Texas. These states face increased hazards from, you know, like hurricanes and floods and heat waves and vector-borne diseases. But like I said, they've done the least when it comes to classifying their risks and figuring out who the vulnerable populations are and trying to figure out how they're going to adapt to these changing climate conditions.
Why haven't these states done better?
That's a good question, Stephanie. I'm hoping that this report might help us to have a dialogue with those states that aren't doing much and even with the states that are doing more, because I think that the states who aren't doing much can learn from the states who are doing more. I assume, you know, when it comes to public health and environmental health, the answer is often funding. It comes down to there's no funding for something. So I have a feeling that funding has to do with it. Politics might have something to do with it. Climate change has become a political topic, although we are seeing now less political divide and more people who are, you know, sort of acknowledging that this is a existential risk and being willing to do something about it. But we're not exactly sure what's preventing them. And I hope that that might be a next step for this work.
Do the states who aren't doing as well, do you think they're aware of how they're doing? Or is this going to shed some light for them?
I have a feeling that they are not going to be surprised by our findings. We did reach out to a lot of states and asked them to take a look at the data that we collected. So hopefully they won't be surprised. But I do think that it might be a wake-up call, especially if they see what other states are doing, and maybe they didn't realize that they were as vulnerable as they are, and maybe they didn't realize that they had done less than other states.
Now, you point out that there are some groups that are most vulnerable to this, to the effects of climate change, the health effects. Could you expound on that a little?
Sure. So when you think about vulnerable populations, you think about things like age, right? Children and the elderly are more vulnerable to the health effects of climate change. Those who maybe are sicker, those who are poor are actually more vulnerable. People with money have the resources to move out of floodplains or to move away from coastlines that may be at more risk, but people who are poor don't have that option. And then, as we've been talking about a lot this year, there's the systemic racism that has been going on. And so a lot of the communities that are most vulnerable to the health effects of climate change are also the ones that are Black and Brown communities.
Are there programs out there that you identified that are working?
We did. We found some. So one of the programs that seems to be doing a very good job, and the states that have worked with it are doing better than other states. It's a program out of the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. And it's called the BRACE program. And it basically provides funding for states to do vulnerability assessments, to do risk assessments on what parts of their state are vulnerable to what types of climate change and where and the most vulnerable populations. But it also gives them funding to plan for what's going to happen when it comes to climate change and health, and also to implement programs that might be able to help the state adapt and prepare for those. So in the report, we highlighted a couple places that have actually taken some concrete actions to protect vulnerable populations. Like in New York City, they have it's called Be a Buddy. And it's a program in where volunteers check on people that are at high risk for heat-related illness. And I think it started about 3 years ago, and it has been activated about 20 times for extreme temperatures. And according to them, they've reached over 450 at-risk residents to hopefully prevent heat-related illness and death.
If we don't do more to mitigate the effects of climate change, we're going to find that a lot of places in this country are going to verge on uninhabitable. How are those states supposed to prepare?
Oh, this is a good question. Public health views housing and a place to live as an important part of our health, right? If we don't have somewhere that's safe to live, then we're probably not going to be very healthy. And so I think climate change brings this to a whole other level. You know, often we talk about safe places to live, and maybe we talk about crime rates, or maybe we talk about air pollution rates. But, you know, when it comes to climate change, there are parts of our country that, as you said, might actually disappear. They might be gone. And so people who've grown up there, whose families maybe have passed down houses from generation to generation, it's not always as simple as just saying, well, just move, right? So how do we help people who live in the most vulnerable areas in order to make sure that they're being protected, especially if they're poor and they can't afford to move on their own? That's a good question. I don't know if we exactly have the answer for that yet.
Well, I think it's a really challenging question. I wasn't sure you'd have the answer, but I think that it's something to think about, right? I mean, the temperatures, if they keep rising at this rate, I mean, Maryland is going to be like Florida, and Florida is going to be like, who knows, right?
Yes. Yeah. There's some scientists that have actually, I think there might even be a website where you can check and see what will your state be like in the future because of climate change. And I think they do those exact same comparison that you just mentioned.
So when we talk about climate change, we don't always think about the health impacts, do we?
No, most people don't. You know, most people just think about maybe the temperature or the floods, but there's so many other health impacts of climate change that I didn't even mention. You know, water security is a really important impact related to climate change, and water is vital to health, right? I mean, if without clean drinking water, we can't survive. And also, you know, water can be a source of unrest, civil unrest. And there are, you know, there are states in this country who fight over water sources. And there are countries around the world who get into wars over water sources. And there are people who flee from where they've grown up lives because maybe they don't have water to use on their crops anymore, or they can't give their animals water to drink. And so there's also what we call climate refugees. It's not something that a lot of people think about, I think, maybe because it can seem removed from the discussion. You know, you think about climate change itself is complex enough between the greenhouse gases and what causes it. And then to take that a step further and think about the impacts of climate change, it's something that I think we need to talk about more. And that's why I'm glad that we have this report to begin the discussion.
Where do you want this discussion to go?
I'm really hopeful that we will come up with a national climate change and health plan. You know, I think for now, the states are doing the best that they can. And, you know, with CDC's BRACE program and guidance from them, there is work happening, but it's not enough and it's not coordinated. So I think Congress should enact legislation to create a plan like that. And I think they should also fully fund CDC's climate and health program, which is where this BRACE funding comes from. I think every state should be a BRACE-funded state. And, you know, another key program at the federal level that fully funding it would help with climate change is called the National Environmental Public Health Tracking Network. It's quite a mouthful, but basically it's the United States' way of tracking what are the environmental hazards, where they are, how they're impacting our health. And it breaks things down by community. And yet, but less than 25 states get funding to do this type of like tracking of environmental health data. But it's not just at the federal level that we need to focus our efforts. The states need to do more as well, right? So even if they don't get funding for CDC's BRACE program, they can still use the framework. They can still do the steps that are laid out by CDC. Those are very public. And I think, too, one of the key takeaway messages is we want states to work with communities. That's something that I think public health is really trying to do more of. It's instead of, you know, just telling communities what they should do, but listening to communities, working with them and understanding their concerns and being part of the community and not just talking to the community.
Megan Latcha, you've given us a lot to think about. Thanks so much for your time.
Thank you, Stephanie.
Public Health On Call is produced by Joshua Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, Stephanie Desmond, and Lamari Morales. Audio production by Spencer Greer, Niall Owen McCusker, Cian Oates, and Matthew Martin, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Thank you for listening.